Well, good morning, everybody, and welcome to church. Happy Sabbath. It is so good to have you all here. Not only this Sabbath day, but this Canada Day weekend. I see some new faces. I see some visitors. I see some people who are returning and visiting us once again. Just want to say welcome to all of you. Now, would you please take a moment, turn to somebody next to you and wish them a happy Sabbath? Could you do that right now? Wish somebody a happy Sabbath. Now, folks, you'll notice that the deacons right now, they're walking around and they're handing out this handout, and you're going to want that to follow along with my message today. So please, if you don't have one, put up your hands, and we'll be more than happy to make sure that you get one of those as well. Now, again, on behalf of all of us here at Nepean, we want to say thank you for joining us today. You could have gone anywhere for worship, but you chose to be with us. Now, here at our church, our motto is to love God, love people, and serve the world. And we're about to, I'm going to ask Dalton to come up, and he's going to share with you some announcements that actually demonstrate how we love God, we love people, and we serve the world. Dalton, please share those with us.
All right. So our first announcement for today is the Hour of Prayer Power. As we already know, every Sunday at 7 p.m., 7 to 8 p.m. So it's easy and free access to everyone. So you can come and join for the full hour or for half an hour. So please, don't forget. You just log in to the website of our Nepean Seventh-day Adventist Church, and you're going to see this banner there, and you just click it in, and you're going to be able to join the Hour of Prayer Power. So every Wednesday at 7 p.m., that is, we have our encounter to study the Bible, and 1 Thessalonians is the book that Pastor is giving a deep explanation for us, kind of a verse by verse, word by word. So please, if you have, if you can, so please join every Wednesday at 7 p.m. I guarantee you that you're not going to regret. So every Wednesday, please. So communion next Sabbath. So please do not forget that next Sabbath we're going to have a communion here in our church, so we ask everybody to please put this in your agenda. Oh, it's right there. I think I have, okay, that is all part of the same announcement. Okay, that's good. So let's move forward. And Bible Vacation School. So Vacation Bible School. I just switch a little bit here, huh? But you all understood. That's the good part, okay? So VBS, okay? So when it's going to happen? July 10th, which is the following week, July 10th to 14th. So it's ages 6 to 12, and it's going to be in the morning part. So is we still have, and I think we can still bring the kids in. If you know anybody, if you have a friend, if they're looking for some activities for the little ones, that's the best one, okay? So let's bring in our kids to participate on a vacation Bible school, right? So I'm going to ask Pastor to come up. So he's going to say something about this.
As you all know, or you should know by now, the People Matter Project is the community-based evangelistic outreach program of our church. It is our evangelistic face out in the world. So think of taking personal ministries, evangelism, community services, and you put that all under one ministry, and that is the People Matter Project. And one of our goals is to actually build relationships with our community. So you know today is Canada Day, and there are going to be Canada Day celebrations all around the city. And we were praying about it, and we were thinking about it, and we realized this is a really great opportunity to go where people are to engage them in ministry. And so what we are doing today is we're setting up a booth over at Clarksfield Park, which is actually the skate park just down the road. It's on Strandherd Drive. You can't miss it as you go down. You can also put it into your phone and it'll take you there. And folks, we're going to be giving out water. We're going to hand out some snacks. We even have a watering station for pets. We're bringing literature with us. And we just want to spend the day engaging the community, just letting them know that the Adventist Church is here. We care about people. And again, just doing it Jesus' way. Go where the people are. Let them know we love them. So if you have some time today after church, just pop on over. Stop by our booth. Talk to people, engage them, and we're just looking forward to getting to know our community and letting them know who we are. So again, after church, Clarksfield, hope to see you there.
Membership transfer. We have from the Francophone English Church in Ottawa. We have, I apologize for if I do some name, Farence Dance, which is coming from the Francophone English Church in Ottawa to our church. So that's the second reading, and I'd like to ask that is anybody here is in favor of this transfer? Have to ask it, right? Is that correct? I'm right or am I wrong?
Okay, so moved.
Let's go on. So, second? All right. In favor? Everybody raise your hand, please. That's good. Thank you. Yeah, can we see him? Can we? Where is our brother? He's right there. Thank you. Can you stand, please, sir? Okay, that's good. Good to have you here. Thank you. Okay, so Sharon Ann Miner is coming from Calgary to our church. She's here today? And this is the second reading as well. Okay? So where is she? Was right there. Okay, that's good. Can you stand, please? That's good. That's right there. Okay. But anyways, let's vote this right now. Okay. Let's go for the motion. Okay. Second. And everybody's in favor. Thank you very much. So is carried. So here we have a second reading as well for John Olel from Fredericton, Seventh-day Adventist Church, to our church. So is he here today? We have him here today or no? But anyways, that's the second reading. We're going to ask for a motion. Right here, second. And everybody's in favor? All right, he's carried. And that is all. So we're going to have one more announcement, and this is from GIC.
Actually, we can wait on that announcement for one sec.
Yeah?
Okay. First of all, I have two announcements, and the first is I'm going to be gone next week. I'm going to be heading to Berman University. I'm flying out tomorrow. I'm going to be there for a ministerial convention. I'm going to be acting as a host to one of the seminars and workshops. I won't be getting back until basically late on Thursday, resuming my duties on Friday. I'll be here for the communion service. And by the way, folks, you want to be here early for communion Sabbath because communions at Nepean, whether you know it or not, is a packed house. We are a full church on communion Sabbaths. Now, the second announcement I have is that we have a married couple here in our church who happened to share the same birthday. Did you know that? Can you imagine meeting your soulmate and you both share the same birthday? And I just want to wish Della and Paul a very special happy birthday. We love you. God bless you. Many more. Amen. Now we can hear Now we can hear from our friends from the GYC.
That's correct. So GYC, please come up.
Good morning, everyone. And a happy Sabbath and happy Canada Day to you all. We have some very, very exciting news about a really exciting event. What are we talking about, Jessica?
Yeah, very exciting event that I came all the way from BC just to announce this to you. And you can now spread it to other people because I can't visit every church. I'm Jessica, and I'm representing Generation of Youth for Christ. So there's an event for, and Eve is going to help me introduce it to you. Anybody who's a teenager, if you're a teenager, I'm talking to you. If you're in your 20s, or if you're in your early 30s, I'm also talking to you. So this event is happening in your area in July, as you can see on the screen, August 16 to 20. It's really close to your area. I have to fly, you don't. You just have to drive. It is called By Life or By Death, as you can see. If you want Bible study, you've been looking for that this summer, you want more Bible study, it's there. If you're looking for seminars where you talk to people about what you heard, not just sit, listen, and go back, but you actually get to talk to the other people there, it's there. If you want to meet people from other parts of Canada, like amazing BC, that's there too. Eve, where exactly is it? On the slide here that's projected so nicely, it says Barrie, Ontario. Is it in a hotel? Where is it?
So basically, we'll be based in Barrie, Ontario, which is pretty much in the Toronto area, just 1 hour and a half north of Toronto. We'll be camping. I will reiterate that we'll be camping in Barrie, Ontario. And why we're camping, because we, for people who used to know about GYC Canada, we used to be in hotels, but we transitioned to camping. Why? Because we want to remove ourselves from distraction, give a chance to young people to connect and to have a relaxed environment, and also to enjoy God's nature. So we'll be camping north of Barrie, actually in Barrie, Ontario.
Awesome. Another thing that's different from year to year, any of you that have gone to AGYC before, the theme is different. What's special about this theme? What's happening this year?
So the theme is By Life or By Death. Don't be scared. It's all about Christ, all about putting Christ up and up front among any circumstances, any consequences, just putting Christ forward. And about the theme will permeate everything that will happen, whether it's the powerful messages, whether it's the seminars or relevant seminars on Christian relationships or mental health, whether it's, it's our addition this year, the hands-on workshop. You will learn some practical skills in terms of natural remedies, self-care, and also if you want to take a break from the cities and you want to have a starter pack on how to live in a country, so come at that conference, you'll have those tools.
It's gonna be packed, that's exciting. Two small details we have to talk about. One is, do we have to register or can we just show up?
Obviously you need to register, and it's pretty easy. Go on the website on gyccanada.org. We are at the regular registration. So basically it was June 2nd to July 15th. So you could go on the website and actually have the chance to profit of a pretty competitive price. And so go on the website and register, it's pretty easy, and all information is there.
Okay, so my last question was, where do I register? And he just said that the website, gyccanada.org, is that right?
Yeah, gyccanada.org. If you have your phone, you could just scan the code. We're pretty techie, so we need to be advanced for these times. So go on the website, the information is there. We're there, so I'm the VP programming. She's the VP networking, so she's the person going in the churches across Canada and making events and whatever. So we're there, and we have Ashley, our resident GYC representative. So just reach out to us, and we're happy to answer questions.
Thank you for having us. Looking forward to seeing you there.
Good morning, happy Sabbath again. All right. Happy to be here. Happy birthday, Della and Paul. And so we're going to invite you to praise with us this morning and sing Glory to God. And this first song, I would like to ask you to sing as a prayer. There's nobody better than anybody else here in this church today. We're all the same. We all need a savior. We all need forgiveness. And so make this your prayer this morning before we start this worship. Please join us.
Pass me not, O gentle Savior. Hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do
God is listening when we cry.
Yes.
So we want His way and not our way, right? We ask for help and He will help, but His way. Sing with us. Singing prayer. We ask Him to help. We ask Him to do His will. Now we rest in His arms. Sing with us, leaning on the everlasting arms.
Thank you.
certainty. But this time I would like to invite you to stand up, and we're going to praise him.
Children, it's your time. Come, everyone, let the little children come to me, Jesus says, for of such is the kingdom of heaven. Maybe I'll put this here in front of me. Okay. Come, everyone, little children, a little bigger children, everybody come. Blessed with all the little children in this church. Come, sit. Okay, are we ready? I have your ears. All right. Happy Sabbath, my dear children. It's so lovely to see you. How are you today? How's everyone? Good, excellent. Hey, I heard the school is done for the year. Is that so? Yeah, perfect. So have a happy and safe summer, okay? All right. So I have a couple questions for you today. likes to read books? May I see your hands, please? All right. Well, many of you, excellent. I like that. Now, the second question is, what kind of books do you like to read? I hope it's good books. Yes? What kind of books?
The Bible.
The Bible, wow.
Bible and adventure books.
Perfect, yes.
Bible and adventure books.
Bible.
Bible?
Every single book.
Every single book. All right. You know, thank you so much. You know what? The Holy Spirit is really working with the children this morning because throughout the week I've been praying for the Holy Spirit to work with the children. And yes, everybody knows they like to read good books. And my story is I want to tell you about this book that is the most important book in the whole world. And I was gonna ask you what kind of book it is, but you already said it because the Holy Spirit is telling you. And this book is not only the most important book, but this book is actually the most powerful book in the entire universe. You believe it? Yes, it is the book that God is giving us. So, children, the Bible, you got it right. I'm talking about the B-I-B-L-E. The B-I-B-L-E. Yes, that's the book for me. I stand alone on the Word of God, the B-I-B-L-E. Yes. You know, boys and girls, this Bible is essential. Do you know what essential means, the word essential? Okay, the word essential is actually, it means needful, it means necessary, it means you cannot go without it, you must have it. All right, so that is what, so we must have this Bible. It doesn't really matter whether you're a child or a teenager, a young adult, an adult, seniors, everyone, we all need the Bible, okay? So that is why God has given it to us. It is like a love letter from Him. You know, the Bible is holy. Why? Because this is the Word of God. And it is the voice of God speaking to us when we read the Bible. And it's basically Jesus talking to you. Jesus, who is your Savior and Lord, and who is your best friend forever. Correct? So, who wants to be near Jesus? Who wants to be, I do. And who wants to get closer and more closer to Him? Ah, me too. So boys and girls, we have the Bible that we can read and study to be near Jesus, okay? And you know what? Jesus also wants to hear from you too. So what do? He wants to hear from you. So talk to Him in prayer, and He would really, really appreciate that. Okay, today I have a little helper. Anna is gonna help us with our memory verse today. Anna?
Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. Psalms 119, verse 105.
Perfect. Excellent. Let's say it together. Shall we, boys and girls? So please repeat after me. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. Psalm 119, verse 105. Great, wow. Truly, the Bible is our lamp to guide and light our path. The Bible helps us to know Jesus, who is our Creator and Redeemer. The Bible is also our guide to know more about Jesus so we may become like Him. So I have a slide now. We are told, may I have the slide, please? Thank you. We are told, boys and girls, it's actually the Bible should be the child's first textbook. Did you understand that? That is your first book in life. And that is from Counsels to Parents, Teachers, and Students, page 108 and paragraph 3. So boys and girls, let us read our Bibles every single day, okay? By the way, do you have a Bible? I mean, do you own one? I really think that everyone should own a Bible. And did you know that Bible comes in different colors and sizes? So I'd like to show you some examples here inside this box. All right, you can help me. Inside this box. All right, just a second. I want to show you. Anna, would you help me tap my microphone? Okay, here. Anna. We have some example of pink Bible and a white Bible. And I have a blue Bible, not so little. I also have, can I put this back? I also have baby Bible, my first Bible, and for a toddler Bible. I also have, what else I have? These two Bibles are for children. This red Bible is called ICB, which is International Children's Bible. It's easy to understand for you. And this Bible is somewhat different because it is a picture Bible, you see? It's a picture Bible, all right? All the stories, and I have also a black Bible for adults. It's a little broken because it's been used quite a bit, but that's all right. And it's old now, and I have one here, and this is, It is a Bible, but it is only the Gospels, the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark. You can read it. Yes. All right. Okay, enough of the Bibles. It is very tiny. You're right. Okay, let me see, because if I don't have this, I forget. Okay, boys and girls, if you don't have a Bible yet, no worries. Kindly ask your parents to buy you one. And I'm sure they will be more than happy, even thrilled, to get you your own Bible. Okay? Thank you, Mom and Dad, for providing the Bible for the children. Now, boys and girls, one of the reasons why it's necessary that we read and study our Bibles today, it's because there is a big warning in the Bible that we need to give careful attention to. May I have the other slide, please? In Amos chapter 8, verses 11 to 12, it says, "Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord God, that I will send a famine on the land, not a famine of bread nor a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. They shall wander from sea to sea and from north to east. They shall run to and fro, seeking the word of the Lord, but they shall not find it." You see, boys and girls, there is a coming day that our Bibles will be taken away from us. And as God had said, we will look for them. We will look for Bibles everywhere, but we cannot find it anywhere. That would be terrible, wouldn't it? It would be a very, very sad day, I know. But wait a minute. There's good news. for you, boys and girls, and you don't have to be sad, because today, like today, July 1st, 2023, the Lord Jesus is asking you, he is pleading that you spend time with him reading and studying the Bible. And you know what? Memorizing Bible verses now will help you prepare when the time of famine comes. Amen? Let's recite our memory verse one more time. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. Psalm 119, verse 105. Excellent. To wrap up this children's corner, let's sing, read your Bible, and pray every day together, and Anna is going to show us the actions. Okay, ready to sing? Yes, stand, please. All right. Read your Bible and pray every day, pray every day. Pray every day, read your Bible and pray every day, and you'll grow, grow, grow. Tippy toes, Anna, yes. And you'll grow, 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 and you'll grow, grow, grow. Read your Bible and pray every day, and you'll grow. Grow, grow. Amen. Anna is going to pray for us now.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you that you love us. Please stop the war in Ukraine. Please heal those who are sick. Help us to be kind to each other and to help those that are in need in you. Help us to be obedient and kind to each other. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen.
All right, thank you for listening. We have lamb's offering today. Please take your baskets with you. Thank you.
Happy Sabbath, my brothers and sisters. The Lamb's offering is just a prelude. It's just the beginning of reaching into our pockets and giving back out of the abundance that God has given us. I want to share with you a very well-known verse. I love it. It's Psalms 34, verse 8. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in him. And when we return our tithes and when we give our offerings, it's showing God that we do trust him with our finances. So I invite the deacons to stand and to prepare to collect the tithes and offerings as we sing Give Thanks. Thank you.
Yes, let's give thanks for how the Lord has blessed us this week, and let us seek him in prayer. So I invite whoever is able to kneel together with me as we talk to God. Heavenly Father, thank you for the Sabbath. Thank you for having protect us during the week and have brought us safely to your house of worship today. Lord, we praise you for the gift of life. We praise you for blessings. We praise you for material and non-material things. Dear Lord, as we bring back these tithes and offerings to you, we just pray that you will help it be distributed in the right way, that the hands that administer it may do it under your guidance and with your wisdom. Dear Lord, as we seek you today in this congregation, we ask that you will bless Pastor Bob as he speaks to us, and may he be your vessel this morning through which you speak to our hearts, and not only speak to us, but that we can also develop a stronger relationship with you. Lord, today is also Canada Day, and we want to thank you for this country. And we know, Lord, that you set up rulers and you put them in the places of power. So, Lord, we ask you to please guide whatever decisions they're making. And we know, Lord, that no country is perfect and no place is perfect here on earth. But the people who are in position, it's because you've allowed it to happen. So, Lord, please bless them and guide them in the decisions that they make. Lord, and I also want to bring the people in this church, in this community, who are not well, who are going through very challenging health issues. We think of Sister Vera, who's gone through surgery, and Lord, we pray for total healing and recovery. We pray for Sister Lena, too, who's also going through one challenge after another with her health. Lord, please be with her. Bless her and give her health if it is your will. Lord, we also put Norm into your hands, and maybe he restored to health according to your will. And there's many others here, Lord, who have other kinds of illnesses or not well, or who might be emotionally struggling or spiritually struggling. And Lord, we place those people in your hands too. We are all sick. This is a hospital, Lord, sick spiritually. And we just pray for health and well-being spiritually. May your Holy Spirit really touch our hearts, open our minds, Lord, and help us see our need for Christ every day. Lord, I also pray for the people who feel no need for you. Especially, Lord, manifest yourself in their lives in some way. I pray that you will forgive our sins and that you will cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We pray to you, Lord, not because we are worthy, but because of Jesus' blood. In your name I pray, amen.
Thank you.
If you but trust in God to guide you and place your confidence in Him, you'll find Him always there beside you to give you hope and strength within. For those who trust God's changeless love, build on the rock that will not move.
He fills your needs to fullest measure
with what discerning love has said.
Doubt not your
sing, pray, and keep His ways unswerving. Offer your service faithfully and trust His word, though undeserving. You'll find His
Amen, amen, amen. I'm bringing you greetings this morning from our sister and fellow church, the Kingston Seventh-day Adventist Church. I was there last Sabbath. I had a weekend with the teens and young adults. We had an amazing time talking about what it means to pursue Jesus. We talked about stepping out and stepping up, making a shift, and looking into eternity and seeing there what God has for all of us and in store for all of us. And they shared with me just how thankful they were, Cynthia and the youth, that our youth went down to Kingston about three Sabbaths ago now. We fellowshiped, shared, interacted, and they fell in love with our youth group. And I want to say thank you to our youth for having something good to say about your church. That meant the world to me. And when your youth are saying good things about your church, good things are happening in your church. And again, on behalf of Kingston, they just want to say thank you for sharing your youth and your pastor with them. And they wish you every blessing. They're a growing church. right now, and they're facing some of the same challenges we are. What do you do with all the people? How do you minister in a building you're outgrowing? And just praising God for what he's doing in other churches. Amen? Now, I want to ask, do you have this handout? This handout is going to be very important to this message today because I have so many points that it's not going to be possible for you to remember them all. And by the way, if you have a pen or pencil handy, you're going to want that because you'll see some incomplete statements, and I'm leaving it up to you to fill in the blanks. So is there anybody who does not have one of these but you would like one? Can you keep your hand up, deacons? Can we grab those handouts and make sure that people, they receive that? We have somebody up here in the front, and we have somebody over here on the side, so if we could make sure that everybody has one that wants one, we appreciate that. Now, for those of you who might be worshiping with us for the first time, and I know some of you are, we have been engaged in this series called The Shift. We started out by asking you to make the shift from being a member in our church to a minister, and then we began this series called The Disciple Shift. And we've been talking about, well, 8 habits of highly effective disciples. We've been talking about if you practice these 8 habits, you can't help but grow in your relationship with Jesus. And today we're on habit number 7, and we're going to be talking about investing. And I want to tell you, I loved that song that Deborah had the children singing, read your Bible, pray every day, pray every day, pray every day, and you'll grow, grow, grow. Well, folks, if you practice the 8 habits of a highly effective disciple, especially this one today, you will grow, 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 because the goal of a disciple is not only to follow Jesus, but to be like Jesus. And so we're going to be talking about habit number 7 today, investing in your spiritual growth and the spiritual growth of others. And today we want to make the shift from hoarding to investing. Now, before we get into the word, could we please have a word of prayer? Oh, Father God in heaven, Lord, we are here as your children. We're in your house together because we're committed to community. We're committed to the mission to which you've called us, Lord. We are here because we have this desire to not only follow Jesus and be like Jesus, but we want to worship Jesus, Lord, and we want to have a Jesus encounter here in our church today. And Lord, as we come to this message, well, this presentation, as we talk about the importance of investing in the spiritual growth of not only ourselves, but Lord, more importantly, in the spiritual growth of those around us, I pray, Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name, you would be poured out. Your servant needs you, your help, your gifting, your outpouring. Lord, you know I'm not capable or even worthy of the task before me. But God, you called, and Hineni, here I am. Lord, I'm here to serve. And Holy Spirit, I can't do that on my own. We can't hear on our own. We can't even respond on our own. So would you please be poured out in us so that we can share the word, hear the word, not only receive it, but live it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, folks, today's message may not sound so much like a sermon today as it might sound like a presentation. And in one of my messages, I shared with you that my key responsibility as your pastor, not my only one, but my main responsibility is to equip and to train. And this is going to feel a little bit more like equipping and training here today. Are you ready? Are you ready? Yes. Amen. That's what I want to hear. How many of you know the name Benjamin Franklin? Anybody here, you've heard of that name? Ben Franklin was a very intelligent man, and he was a bit of a, well, inventor. He had a high level of curiosity. He loved to see how things would work, and he was experimenting with things all the time. And one of the things he was starting to experiment with was, well, fertilizers and things that would help plants grow. And here's what he discovered. If you took plaster from your home and you ground it up and you put it in the soil and you mixed this plaster into your soil, your crops would not only grow, but they would be thicker, healthier, and more lush. And he thought, this is amazing. So guess what he did? He shared the good news. He started going to his friends and family and farmers in his community, and he was telling them the good news about grinding plaster up and putting it in your field and using it as a fertilizer. Problem was, everybody laughed at him. I mean, what do you mean plaster? Like, Ben, are you a little plastered yourself? Like, are you like kind of, Ben, are you losing it a little? And Ben's like, no, this actually works. You've got to try it. Nobody was willing to try it. They just thought Ben was just kind of a little crazy. Well, the next spring, Ben goes out and he finds, a bit of a ditch that's along the main road, a well-traveled road in his community. And he grabs, a rake, and he starts carving a message in the side of the ditch. And so he breaks up the ground, he puts plaster into the soil, into his message, and then he seeds it with green grass. And then that spring, the grass began to grow. And as the grass began to grow, there was this section of the ditch, this section of grass that was greener and it was healthier and more lush than all the grass around it. And it read, "This has been plastered." Now, before some of you misinterpret Pastor Bob and you say, "Well, Pastor Bob said, if I want to spiritually grow, I got to get plastered," there's always one of those in the church. Have you ever noticed? Somebody who likes to misquote the pastor and try and get away with something? That's not what I am saying here this morning. What I am saying is that there are things you can do. There are things that you can pour into your life and into the life of others. And if you do it, not only will they grow, but you will grow too. And so if you found that you're kind of stagnant in your spiritual growth, maybe it's because you're hoarding and not investing. Now, here at our church, we know that we are called by God to do something for God. We've been talking about this, and there are a number of things you are called to do. And one of those things you are called to do is to be a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. But not only are you called to be one, but you are called to do what? Make one. Oh, I should be getting a larger response than that. We are called to be one so we can make one. Let's hear it. Be one. Okay, now we're getting it. You are called to be one in order to make one. And this has become the mission focus of our church here at Nepean. Our mission has to do with, you are called to invite, equip, and empower others to become a fully devoted follower of Jesus Christ. So you are called by God to not only be a disciple and a fully devoted follower of Jesus, but you are called to help and empower, invest in other people so that they too can become a fully devoted follower of Jesus Christ. Is this our mission at Nepean? Have we not agreed that this is a biblical mission given to us by God Himself? Now, this has been our Bible text throughout this entire series. We come back to it from time to time. And you know it. It's Matthew 28, 19 and 20. "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." You are called by God to do something for God, and that is to be one so that you can make one. Now, here's the thing. If you are going to be a fully devoted follower and you're going to help somebody else be a fully devoted follower, understand what we're talking about here is spiritual growth. Because again, the goal is not to just follow Jesus, but it is to connect with Jesus so that when you grow up and you spiritually mature, you too can be like Jesus. Is that biblical? Not only are you called to do this, hear me. Not only are you called to do this as an individual, we are called to corporately do this as a church. Yes. Is this biblical? Yes. Those of you who are with us on Wednesday nights, you would know this is biblical. Look at this, Ephesians 4, 11 through 15. It was he who gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, and some to be pastors and teachers to prepare God's people for works of service so that the body of Christ might be built up. That's growth. Until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become, that's growing up. Attaining to the whole measure, growing up of the fullness, growing up of Christ. What's the goal? To be like Jesus. Then we will no longer be infants tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of men in their deceitful scheming. Now look at this. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will in all things grow up into him who is the head, that is Christ. You are called by God to do something for God, and it's to grow up. Oh, you're a little quiet on that one. I hope I wasn't being harsh when I said grow up. Because you are called by God to grow, but he's not asking you to grow up by yourself. He's asking all of us to grow up and to do it together and to do it in a way that all of us will spiritually grow together because we're in it together as family. Amen? So I want to talk a little bit this morning about what it means to spiritually grow, and this is where your handouts are going to become important now. And again, I'm going to leave it up to you to fill in the blanks. So follow along. I'm going to talk about spiritual growth, what it is and what it is not. At first, I'm going to start out with, well, what it is not. And here's what you need to know. Growth is not automatic. It's not like one day you woke up and you said, you know what, I'm going to get saved, give my life to Jesus, I got baptized, and that's it. All of a sudden, automatically, I'm spiritually mature. Can I ask how many of you had a little growing to do after you got baptized? So most of you were perfect when you came up out of the waters? Is that what I'm saying? Okay, so Pastor, you're the only one who needed some more extra work. Is that what I'm saying? No, we all know we did not come out of the baptismal waters perfect, mature, completely like Christ. This is a process we call sanctification. Sanctification is the process whereby you are learning in your salvation how to be like Jesus, and you have to choose to be a part of that process. Right? If you've decided one day that, hey, you know what, I'm out of shape and I want to get into shape, you don't get into shape by saying, I want to get in shape. How do you get into shape? Right, you got to choose to do the things that will put you into shape. It doesn't automatically happen. I can't walk into the gymnasium, look at the weights, and all of a sudden buff up. I wish, especially on leg day. Oh my goodness, how I wish I could look at the weights on leg day. But it doesn't work that way. You actually have to choose it. And let me be clear here. You choose it not because you told yourself you need to do it. You will choose this because you want to do it. Now, do we need to grow up? Yes. But just because you need to do something doesn't mean you want to do it. Have you ever noticed that about people? Have you ever noticed somebody's demeanor when they say to you, I need to do this? And you know you need to. But you won't until you actually want to. Because people don't necessarily do what you need to do. You will do it if you want to do it. And when it comes to growing up, you have to want to do it. Right, you've got to choose it, brother. So you also need to know that growth is not instantaneous. In other words, It is a process. And this is why Sister White says that when it comes to sanctification, it is the work of a what? It's a work of a lifetime, because there is a process to this. It doesn't happen overnight. Again, I go back to the gym. If you want to build muscle and you want to get into shape, women, men, you want to get healthier, maybe tone, maybe a little more buff, maybe you just want to get your cardio and heart health up, understand that doesn't happen because you went to the gym one day, right? You wish, right? You wish. It is not instantaneous. It takes time. Now, I got to talk to the mature Christians in the church for a sec. We got to have a little word here about patience with those who were new to their relationship with Jesus Christ. Amen. Right? Because so many of us measure other people's growth by where we are currently. Right? I've been doing this for 50 years. Some of you have been at this a little longer, some of you not so long, but understand I am not in my maturity the same person I was when I was 9 years old and I came into the faith. When I came into the faith, I had a mouth that uttered words that are not to be uttered. And it took me a while to have God sanctify that tongue. Right? There are some of you where God had to sanctify your temper. Some of you, your patience, some of you, what you're engaged in for entertainment. And what so many of us forget is that in our growth, all the mistakes we had, all the backsliding, all the sin we committed, and by God's grace, we gained victory and growth, and we got sanctified to the point where there are things that used to attract me but no longer have any pull. But it took me 50 years to get there. And then we treat somebody who comes into the church and we see some sin we used to fall victim to, and we want to stomp it out right now because we're not willing to give somebody the grace they need to grow that we needed, but now we no longer provide. Please do not expect instantaneous growth and victory over sin from those who are new in Christ. Give them the grace to grow because it's not instantaneous. And you better be thankful God gave you the grace to grow. Now, growth is not measured by what you believe. Now, let me be clear here. It's important to study the Word, and it is very important to come into contact with truth and know truth. But now let me ask you something. Is there somebody out there who knows the truth so well it scares him? Just biblical. Is there somebody out there who knows the truth, maybe better than all of us here, and it terrifies him? Satan. Satan knows, and he believes. And he believes it so much, it actually terrifies him. But let me ask you something. Is he a mature Christian?
No.
Why not? Because beliefs that do not transfer into behaviors are just that. It's just information. Take the Pharisees. The Pharisees knew their Bibles. Memorized the first 5 books of the Bible. These guys were good. Now you try memorizing Deuteronomy or Leviticus. I will give you a prize for that, okay? First person who comes up and can give me the whole book of Leviticus off by heart, I'll give you $50. I'll make it $100. I'll sweeten the pot. Good luck with that. But these boys, all 5 of the first books of the Bible. But were they fully devoted followers of the one we call Jesus Christ? Why not? Because beliefs that do not transfer into behaviors do not make you mature. You're not mature until you're living what you know. Here's what Jesus said. He said, Jesus replied, in Matthew 22, 29, you are in error because you do not know the scriptures or the power of God. Now, what an insult to a group of people who just memorized the first 5 books of the Bible. But the problem was, is that they didn't know the word enough for it to transform their lives. is not about what you believe. It's about who you're following and who you're becoming like. If you're reading the Word and you're not becoming like Jesus, then you're not really reading the Word. Growth doesn't happen just by yourself. I cannot tell you how often I've had somebody come up to me and say, I can be a Christian without the church. No, you cannot. That is a secular idea, not a biblical idea. Nobody grows in isolation. There are times when our kids will act up and they will do something that will annoy us because it's us. You hear what I'm saying, brother? It's one thing when it's you doing it, but it's another when you see your kid doing something that reminds you of you and it irritates you. And the kids get into trouble, and then they're apologizing, and my wife will shake her head, and she'll say, you know what? I understand. You weren't created from thin air, right? You are a reflection of your parents, right? Here's the thing. Your growth in Christ doesn't happen out of thin air. It happens because you belong to a community of believers who are determined to achieve the same thing you're determined. You are on the same journey, and that is to become like Jesus. Let me tell you something. There are times when I go on a journey, a trip, or maybe I'm hiking, and I like to surround myself with people who've been here before so they can share their wisdom with me. Right? I like a tour guide. I like somebody who can say, hey, listen, you don't want to eat here, you want to eat over there. You don't want to go to that place. You don't want to go to, you want to go here. You want to do this. This is the best price. This is what you want, because their wisdom and experience is now being poured into me. And what you want to do is surround yourself with people who can pour that wisdom and experience into you, because you're not going to learn that by yourself. Unless, of course, you find yourself the only Christian in your community. But find yourself a community. And here's what you need to know. Growth doesn't happen just by attending church. Right? Growth doesn't happen just because I'm sitting in the gym watching other people work. Right? Right? You don't learn a skill by watching somebody else do it. Eventually, you yourself have to apply what you're learning. And I can't tell you how often I've come to church and there's somebody who's been there 30, 40, 50 years, and they are no more mature today than they were the first time they came up out of the baptismal waters. They go to church, but they refused to grow up. Have you ever had somebody in your life that simply refused to grow up and they were immature? What was that like? What was that relationship like? You see, it's not automatic. It's not instantaneous. It's not measured by your beliefs. It doesn't happen just by yourself, and it doesn't happen just because you came to church. You got to choose it. You got to want it, and you need to be committed to it. Now, this is where now we make the transition. So let's talk about what spiritual growth is. And growth is intentional. And we just talked about this. And by intentional, I mean you are actually planning to make it happen. That's what intentionality is. I have a goal that I am determined to pursue and to make happen. That's intentionality. Before, I remember a story of a guy who was going on a cruise. And he was widowed, and he just wanted to meet other people. And while he was on the deck of the ship, he was walking around, and his eye caught this other lady. And her eye caught his eye. And she's looking at him, and the next thing you know, she's smiling at him. His heart's like, whoa, okay, this is good. So later that evening, he goes into the dining room, and he's looking for her. And he sees her sitting by herself. And so his intent, he wants to spend time with this lady, and his plan is to go over and ask if he could eat with her. And he does. He walks over. He asks if this seat is taken and if she would be okay, if they could eat together. And he said to her, by the way, like, you have an amazing smile. I saw your smile, and I thought, I just want to get to know you. And she said, that's okay. She said, I'd like to have supper with you because you remind me of my second husband. You look an awful lot like my second husband. And he said, well, how often have you been married? And she said, once. She has intention. Now you're getting, some of you are going, oh, okay, now I get it. She had a better line than he did. Yeah, you follow what I'm saying. But what was her intention? We're going to make relationship happen. But isn't that the goal of the Christian life? Me and Jesus, and I'm intent on making relationship happen. But not only for me and Jesus, but I'm going to be intentional about helping you develop a relationship with Jesus. Because you see, what I'm intent on is investment. Well, what is an investment? It's you taking something of value and pouring it into something else because you believe it will grow and produce more. You see, I'm intent, and not because I'm your pastor. I'm doing this because I'm your brother in Christ. I'm doing this because somebody did this for me. Somebody saw in Bob Windsor the potential of a relationship with Jesus Christ, and they loved me, mentored me, and helped to grow me so that I could grow up into Jesus. And we are called to invest in each other's relationship because we're going to take something of value, which might be your time. It might be money. It could be energy, but you're going to take something of value that you have and you're going to pour it into somebody else because you believe it's going to grow into a relationship with Jesus that could produce fruit you may not know or understand till the kingdom. You are called to be intentional not only in your growth, but investing in the growth of others. And this means commitment. It means you're going to become committed to this community because this is where I'm going to invest. Right now, right here, the thing that is in front of me right now to invest in is all of you. And so, like Benjamin Franklin, I want to pour into you something that's going to grow you so that the end result is Jesus, but I have to be committed to loving on you, serving on you, and being committed to be in that relationship with you that we both grow into a relationship with Christ. And then you're committed to the calling. This means you are committed to the very thing that God has called you to do. You're going to be committed to following Jesus, and then you're going to become committed to helping others to follow Jesus. And in the commitment to that calling, you're going to understand the core of this church. What is its mission? What is our vision? Where are we heading? Who it is we're trying to reach? Why we're trying to reach them the way we do? And you're going to be committed to that calling and that mission and that vision. And then you're going to become committed to the commission. And that is to understand how it is the Holy Spirit has gifted you to make this investment happen. On the day that you got baptized, you were given a gift by the Holy Spirit. Did you know that? You were gifted by the Holy Spirit on the day of your baptism in order that that gifting could grow you, grow your church, help your church become healthy, and then empower you to turn around and then help somebody else grow in the relationship with Jesus. That's the gift. And we're going to be talking about that in the fall, about the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit. Bible says you'll receive power. You started receiving that on the day you were baptized and you made a commitment to your relationship with Jesus. And the Holy Spirit, God the Helper, has been investing in you and pouring into you heavenly blessings, heavenly strength, heavenly gifting so that you can grow and then turn around and help others grow as well. Let me ask, when was the last time you got on your knees and you said, God, I'm all in? I've been listening to the series, Father. I want to make the shift. I want to shift to becoming just not a member, but I want to be a minister. God, I hear you calling me to follow Jesus and be like Jesus, but Lord, I want to be committed to investing in the church, the people who go there, my community, because God, I want to be committed to saving people the same way you saved me. I want to be committed to growing people the same way you grew me. When was the last time you got on your knees and said, I'm all in? When was the last time you said to God, Lord, I want to be a part of what's happening at Nepean. Grow me, help me, make me. And then understand, once again, growth is a process. And you have to be committed to that process. Take the time with God. Ask the Holy Spirit how the Holy Spirit wants to grow you. And understand it happens on a day-to-day basis, week-to-week, month-to-month, year-to-year. But at some point, you have to develop your plan for spiritual growth. And again, I use the same analogy of going to the gym. You see, you won't grow at the gym without a plan. You need to know what muscles you're going to work. You need to know how you're going to work them, the order in which you're going to work them, the day of the week in which you are going to work them, and then you have to have a plan for feeding your muscles, and then you got to have a plan for resting your muscles. Your spiritual growth is no different. What's your plan for growing like Jesus? What's your plan for helping other people to grow like Jesus? Because intentionality is, I am determined to make something happen, and process is how we're going to do it. Now, here's what happens to people who do not have a plan for growth. This comes from A.W. Tozer. He said, think about people who find themselves in religious ruts. They discover a number of things about themselves. They will find that they are getting older, but not getting any holier. Time is their enemy, not their friend. The time they trusted and looked to is betraying them, for they often said to themselves, the passing of time will help me. I'll get better as I get older. I know some good old saints, so as I get older, I'll get holier and better. Time will help me, purify me, and revive me. Sanctification through old age. They said that the year before last, but they were not helped any last year. Time betrayed them. They were not any better last year than they had been the year before. In other words, they didn't plan to grow up. Folks, do you know the saying, a failure to plan is a plan to fail? Spiritual growth, it's personal. How Jesus is going to look in me might look a little different than how Jesus is going to look in you. And the process that God is going to use to grow me and the stages he will grow me and the things he's going to work on might look different in you. I remember when my dad got saved. Now understand, my dad had been drinking rum, hard rum, was an alcoholic, high-functioning alcoholic, but he was an alcoholic, and since the age of 13, he'd been smoking cigarettes. He got saved. And my dad instantly went cold turkey without withdrawal. God just took it away right away. What God didn't take away was my dad's impatience. I met some people where they struggled with overcoming addiction, but they were really great with patience. You see, one of the reasons why you got to be careful with people is that right now, the Holy Spirit might not be working on my addiction because the greater issue might be my patience. Or it might be the easiest to overcome while teaching me how to live a life of victory over victory and over victory. And you don't know what the Holy Spirit's plan is for my growth. So what you might have overcome in your life, let me tell you something. Some of the harshest people are the people who've already gained the victory over a sin that somebody else is struggling with. One of the harshest critics of other people, one of the harshest critics of smokers, is former smokers. And they become harsh on people who've not yet gained the victory they have. And you need to understand that I might need right now to work on gaining a victory in another area of my life, because the Holy Spirit doesn't, like, you can't get rid of it all, overcome it all, and have victory over it all at once. It doesn't work that way. It has to be a part of a process, because sometimes the process of victory over sin, it needs to be a process so it becomes so rooted in your mind, the why, the battle for that victory, the power of sin, the work of overcoming temptation becomes so ingrained in your mind that you understand the importance of never returning to that sin. And for some of us, that lesson takes a little longer than others. And you may not know why somebody else is sinning. So your growth is personal. And here's the thing, I can't give you my growth. I can't give you my faith. I can't give you my victory. But what I can do is I can come alongside you and be there for you as you're learning to grow in Jesus. And spiritual growth has to be practical. Look, you have to find the things that work for you in your relationship with Christ. Because the methods and strategies that I used for victory may not be the same strategies that will work for you. Do you hear me? So, for example, you all know that before COVID, there was less of me, more of Jesus, less of me, but I was a lighter man. And the way I got there is because I understood that I don't do well with carbs. I look at carbs, I gain weight. I look at cake, I gain weight. Some of you are like, I've been there, Pastor. I know what that's about. For some of you, it could be the fats. For some of you, your strategy might be more cardio. For some others, your strategy might be, I want to lift more weights. But understand that it has to be practical. It has to be something you need to understand how you grow, what the Holy Spirit is calling you to. But the goal is to be intentional, to have a plan, work the plan, and then do the things that actually give you victory. Make it practical, make it doable. And then spiritual growth, it's about people. You read here today, we are called to be in this together. When I was in Alberta, I had four friends. There were five of us. And we realized that we were all on the same journey. We all wanted to be like Jesus. And at any time, I could go to those men and I could trust them. I could trust them with my struggle. I could trust them with my sin. And we would come together and we would hold each other accountable, and we'd ask each other about your marriage and you know what, are you being a good dad? Are you being a good husband? What are you doing? You've got gifts and you've not been using them. Why are you not using your gifts for Jesus? As brothers, we could look at each other and say, hey, listen, give your head a shake. You're not in the right place right now. One of my friends was going through a divorce, and we would nurture him, support him, and pray for him. And then one day, I had to look him in the eyes and say, get over the pity party and grow up. He got mad at me, didn't speak to me for 2 months. But he thanked me for telling him exactly what he needed, even if he didn't like it. Because you see, growth is about people. We could have ignored each other. We could have neglected each other. But we understood the key to being a Christian is to helping other people grow. So we started a men's group. Share the love, share the support. 15 men would come out on a Wednesday night, and for 6 years, 15 men would get together and we would hold each other accountable. We would pray for one another, support one another, and we got to the point where we could share stuff you typically wouldn't share with people. Eventually, after 6 years, we disbanded the group. And a year later, and I kid you not, the wives of every single one of those men came to me and said, "Would you please start that group again? Because my husband was a better man and a better Christian when he worshiped together with other men in the church." You don't grow in isolation. You grow in family. You hear me? You don't grow in isolation. You grow in family. And spiritual growth isn't just about you. If all you're doing isn't, all you are is in this for you, all you're doing is hoarding. And this happens. If you notice, maybe it's happened to you where you come to church and you feed. And I'm hoping today you've been feeding and we've been worshiping and praying and singing. You get the message and you feed. And then we got Sunday nights. It's the hour of prayer power and you go and you pray and you got fed. And then hopefully on Wednesday nights you come join us and you got fed. And maybe you're part of the young adult group and on Friday night you just got fed. You know what? You're feeding and you're feeding and you're feeding, and you got to the point where you moved from healthy to toxic because all you did was take in, but you never gave anything out. You can literally do healthy things and become toxic because you didn't do the one thing that was important in your spiritual growth, and that was to take what God has poured into you and then to pour it into somebody else. You were called by God to do something for God, and that is to take what you have received and to pour it into others. Has God poured anything into your life? Does God pour anything into your life? Jesus said to the woman at the well, "I'm going to give you living water. And if you drink from the living water, if you drink from what I will give you, what will she turn into? A fountain that would become a spring that would pour living water into those around her." Jesus was calling her to do something for Jesus, and that was to let the springs flow. And she did it in an instant. Spiritual growth isn't just about you. She had received the gospel of Jesus Christ. She didn't keep that to herself. She went and she took that and she poured that living water into other people. You see, spiritual growth is about knowing Christ, then loving Christ, then growing in Christ, then serving Christ, then sharing Christ. In other words, you are called by God to love God, love people, and serve the world. Don't be like the Dead Sea. You all know this analogy. Over in Israel, you can hop on a plane, go to Israel, take a tour. You can go to the Dead Sea. And it's, you know what it's famous for. It's dead. That's what it's famous for. Oh, okay, I get it. There's a lot of salt in the water, and you can have fun just floating on the water. You can lie back, read a magazine, you know. Don't go to sleep, you might roll over. But you know it's famous for being dead, and it is so dead that you can't even sink in it. But let me ask you, how is it that this body of water can be so dead when millions and gallons of living water pour into it every day? Living water is poured into the Dead Sea every day, and it's still dead. Why? And you all know the truth, you know the analogy. It's dead because while living water goes in, living water does not go out. You are to be an instrument and a funnel of living water. And God has poured into you living water and living water and living water. And you have a decision to make. You can hoard the water, and eventually you will die. and everything spiritually around you, it will die too. Make no mistake, if you hoard, it becomes toxic and things die. Or you can make the shift. You can shift right now from hoarding to investing and taking the living water that God has poured into you and pour it into somebody else. God has called you to do something for God. And what he's called you to do is to invest, to share that living water so that others too can become a fully devoted follower of Jesus Christ. And if you practice these 8 habits we've been teaching, this is habit number 7. If you practice these habits, you cannot stay where you are. You will grow. It will grow your kids. It'll grow your family. It will grow your friends. It will grow the church. And it will grow you. You have a choice. Do you hoard or do you invest? But if you invest, you will become that fountain of living water that creates other fountains. Please let your water flow.
I wish I had a hymn talking about the flowing water. But we can flow in many different ways. And one is singing about Jesus and singing about our Redeemer. And so please stand and let's sing. I'll sing of my Redeemer.
Through all the cruel trials he suffered.
Let's close with prayer. Father God in heaven, Lord, your mercy and your grace and your love is unequaled. It is unparalleled. There is no God like our God. And today, Lord, we have come to worship you, to lift up the name of Jesus, Lord, to talk about what it means to follow Jesus. Lord, we thank you that you were determined to save us. Well, we're thankful that you had a plan to save us, and that, God, you had the will and the great grace and ability to carry out that plan. We're here by your grace. Lord, I pray now that as we leave your house, we too will leave determined, that we too will leave with the plan, that we too would leave here with this desire to be living waters that are connected to who find their source in the living water. That water has a name, and his name is Jesus. And Lord, we want to be like him. So I pray that you would bless these wonderful people who are here today, Lord. We have come to worship, we've come to pray, we came to sing. We came to encounter you, and Lord, we have, and as we leave here, would you keep your word that should always be with us, even to the end of the age. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, thank you all for coming out and being a part of our worship today. Please, if you have some time this afternoon, check out our booth over at Clarksville Park. God bless. Have a blessed week.